streets of Chinatown, it isn't difficult to see that this is a teeming, crowded community. And that's the problem. Because of the United States immigration law, thousands of Chinese from Hong Kong have been pouring in this year to an already crowded Chinatown in New York City. The small community, already bursting at the seams, has many critical problems that collectively add up to a Chinese puzzle. Where do all the people go? And what about the language barrier, education, and health problem? But the most serious problem of all continues to be housing, which many feel is more critical in Chinatown than in Harlem. One deeply concerned is Chung Ping Tom, Chinatown's mayor. He is not only concerned with the housing shortage, but the many problems that stem from it. Although Chinatown has tenements, they've never had slums. The streets are crowded, but clean. And the people here will not go in relief. They're proud. Mr. Tom and others feel that if they solve it with government aid, take funds without earning it, that the Chinese traditions of honor and self-respect will be threatened. Mrs. Mui Ing, one of the public health nurses from the Community Service Society, commented on the good behavior of the Chinese youth under these trying conditions, and then suggested a solution to the housing problem.
I think in due times, if some of these young people learning the language will gradually move out of the community.
Do you think the older people will approve of this?
Why not? I think so. Because it has been done. The second generation Chinese do live out in Long Island, it moved to New Jersey, up in the Bronx, Westchester.
Then you think this is the answer for young people to leave Chinatown?
We hope so. We like to see them assimilate with other groups of
Americans.
Yes.
And many here agree with Mrs. Ng. Leave Chinatown. Leave Chinatown where families of four might have to share an apartment with a family of eight. But Mr. Harold Louis, the new president of Chinatown Planning Council, doesn't think it's necessary to leave Chinatown or to take outside aid.
We do not expect federal, city, or state aid for this critical area of housing in Chinatown. This is an area that we would like to resolve for ourselves by getting people in the community and the lending institutions to extend credit so that we can rehabilitate many of the tenements that are still livable.
Do you expect aid for any of your other problems?
Yes. There are many people that mistakenly think that we are not interested in getting any other kinds of funds for other problem areas such as education and some of our social problems. We have been recipients of anti-poverty funds this summer, and we have ran an education and a Head Start program. We need this kind of assistance, and we would like to be ready to take more on if we can.
One Chinese school teacher summed it up by saying, "We must not forget words like honor and self-reliance." And she went on to say, "We must not destroy the old values, but learn to accommodate the new." This is Jean Parr, WCBS-TV News in Chinatown.
There are few American cities with a greater reputation for social tolerance than San Francisco. Yet its large Asian population would not agree. The Chinese, Japanese, Filipinos, and Samoans living here have suffered from the same pattern of exclusion that has characterized white America's relations with blacks in the South and Mexican Americans in the Southwest. One of GLIDE's current efforts is the Asian Coalition, an organization designed to create a sense of common identity among Asians so that they can speak with more authority. The question of identity has reached crisis proportions among young people who are trying to upset the long-held view that all Asian Americans are docile and contented.
But how do you tell this to the outside people where they have all these stereotypes of us? How do you break these stereotypes?
I think part of the biggest problem is that, you know, we ourselves have met the stereotypes that they give us, you see, and that we, you know, the example of being passive, you know, again, the impact of racism, passive, cute little girls, you know, and us gentlemen, you know, man, kind of the laundryman image, the waiter, the waitress type of thing. I think the thing that really bothers me the most is really the impact of the racism in our community, and that we submerge our hurts, our fear. And this is why a lot of our people are not able to speak out and say how they express what they really feel because of their fear. Mm-hmm. You know, what would happen to them? Would they lose their jobs? You know, would they lose their positions? And this is the sort of thing that we have to express to our people, you know, that you shouldn't be afraid, you know? Be visible. And this is why, in some respect, we're not getting our part of the, you know, so-called war on poverty money. You know, part of it is that we don't let people know that we have problems.
But Tony, how can people come out feeling dignified and not afraid if all they can see is their people of their own race being dishwashers, laundrymen, and not at any visible jobs that have any dignity? Employment has played such an important role in stereotyping the Asians.
Mm-hmm. So like we went down and met with the United Bay Area Crusade Board about 2 weeks ago it was. And after we made a presentation to them, and there were lawyers, there were ministers, there were social workers and teachers and professional people there. And after we made a presentation, and the president stood up and said, thank you for a very good presentation.
Nice presentation.
And if it's a, sort of like a grade school class, you know, one student made a report and the teacher said, yeah, good little boy, you made a good report. Mm-hmm. And they weren't listening at all.
Yeah.
You see, I was just wondering the dilemma of educating a larger community, how best we can do it, and whether in relationship to our own problems, you see, where is our priority? Where should we spend the time? Become a very serious problem.
Education comes on many levels. For example, if the president of the United States is not sensitive to his people, which is a large percentage is Orientals and Asians, mm-hmm. his friend, Lieutenant Kelly, made such a terrible blow to the Asian community because it showed to the Asian that he did not feel the Asians were people.
Right.
That they had a right to kill the Asians. If they did that in Germany, it would be something else. Mm-hmm. But because they were Asians, Lieutenant Kelly was just very nicely dismissed. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that really angered a lot of Asians.
Well, you know, UAC, United Asian Community, in a sense, it's not just happening here in San Francisco. As I travel up and down the West Coast, in Seattle, you know, in Los Angeles, in San Diego, mm-hmm. you know, coalitions are building up. You know, the Asian American social workers are getting together. The Asian American clergymen are getting together. Mm-hmm. You see, there's something more important, something more urgent right now in our society mm-hmm. than dealing with other privileged things like, transcendental religion or communes or a point I get very turned off with ecology. You see, when there's so many people are really suffering and people are tripping somewhere else.
3.5 years after the communist takeover of Vietnam, tens of thousands of Vietnamese still struggle to escape their homeland for a new life elsewhere. The latest to join that exodus are members of Vietnam's middle class who are finding it easier to leave their homes than find new ones. We have a report from Ed Bradley in Malaysia.
Palau Bidong, an island off the Malaysian coast, 25 miles out in the South China Sea, home for more than 24,000 Vietnamese refugees. This is mail call, where they wait day after day for some word that they will be allowed to enter another country to make a new home. All told, nearly 50,000 refugees populate camps like this throughout Malaysia. And while representatives of the United Nations make periodic trips here to bring food, supplies, and mail, it is these letters from friends and relatives who have already made it that are the only real link to the outside. 10 days before?
10 days before.
You tried before?
Yes.
How many people died?
One or two children.
One or two children?
Yes. Because I'm so many sick, I cannot stand.
For the Vietnamese, this is sanctuary. But although they don't realize it because of racial and economic tension, the Malaysians don't want them. And some have been stoned by local villagers along the coast. This is just the beginning of a long process that will send these people to refugee camps in Malaysia, where most will remain in squalid conditions for more than a year. A number of Western countries, including the United States and Canada, have accepted Vietnamese refugees, but scattered around Southeast Asia are 250,000 more. And within a year, some officials expect that number to at least double. But that is the future. And for those who have made good their escape from Vietnam, the young and the old, it is a new, if troubled, beginning. For many, the escape, the hard days at sea, and perhaps the struggle to get ashore are just too much. For one old man, for him, this was journey's end. Ed Bradley, CBS News, Malaysia.
Bradley's report is part of a CBS Reports broadcast on Southeast Asian refugees, which will be seen next month. And that's the way it is, Tuesday, December 19th, 1978. This is Walter Cronkite, CBS News. Good night.
I spent a couple days this month in a small town in Nebraska, which has a new Vietnamese doctor. He's glad to have a place to live. The town's glad to have a doctor. And the doctor's kids are growing up as small town Nebraskans. They will make their own contribution to their new country someday. It's an old American story. What we're about to show you, however, is also an old American story of immigrants rejected by their neighbors, huddling together in the big city for safety, still looking for the latch that will open the golden door. Liz Trott reports our Sunday morning cover story. Now it's their turn. Again.
When they left Southeast Asia, it was for a vision of freedom, for a place where all men were created and treated as equals. Tong Choi had this vision, walking 4 days and nights from his small village in northern Laos, crossing the Mekong River to freedom in a small boat. He met and married his wife in a refugee camp.
The most thing I want to tell you is my own experience as a victim, because that's very close to you.
Nguyen Pham kept the vision of freedom alive too, as he drifted on the South China Sea, watching 60 of his boatmates die slowly. He was rescued by a ship from the 7th Fleet and wrapped in a blanket by an American sailor.
The rich man, the teacher, the officer, anyone working in the government was killed the communists.
Kiet Win walked through the mountains from Cambodia to Thailand with his wife and three children. They spent 17 months in a refugee camp, again with a vision of freedom. Since 1975, when all of Indochina became communist, 650,000 refugees have settled in the United States, Vietnamese, Cambodians, Laotians. It is a small figure, considering that the survival rate among boat people is only about 50%. The federal government chose Boston, Massachusetts as one of the cities for resettling these Asians, 12,000 of them so far. The Dorchester section, with its history of racial trouble, received just under 1,000. Just enough to resurrect the racism of the recent past.
There's very little idea about what they have gone through to get here.
Professor Donald Polk of Boston University, who specializes in race relations.
I heard some of the stories of the people that we work with. I know there were comparable kinds of things that happened to black people. But once you hear them, I really think you have a much better understanding of people swimming with children around their necks and one of the children falling off, and they know they have to go ahead. They know they have to finish crossing the river. that they can't go back for the child.
Well, the first time you throw the window, right?
What Asians have come to share in Dorchester is that they are a common target for oppression and bigotry. A pattern of violence has developed: firebombings, bottle throwings, assaults, attacks on property, and name calling.
They call me a mouse.
A mouse?
Yeah. Him too. You know, every day in Rochester Avenue. You know,
why that?
I don't know. All the young people, you know, all the young people, they drink the beer, drink whiskey. Very happy, very enjoying it. And they come to the United States. And they say, you are a mouse. I don't like that. I am not a mouse. I am not an animal. I am a person, you know. I am a human.
Last month, a U.S. Marine on leave stabbed a young Vietnamese man to death and wounded four of his friends in this Dorchester house. The family of the Vietnamese victim then moved away, and the neighbors burned down the house. By nature, men are nearly alike. By practice, they get to be wide apart. Those are the words of Confucius, something to think about while listening to many of the white youngsters in Dorchester. They are, by nature, kids. They are, by practice, racists in the making. This group of boys was playing in front of a house where some Asian refugees live.
How come the people around here don't seem to be too fond of them?
They don't like chinks.
They don't like what?
Chinks.
Why is that, do you think?
I don't know, the prejudice.
Speak a different language.
They don't spoil the kids speak English.
And they're not white.
Is that bad?
Yeah.
Yep.
Why is that bad?
It just is.
All these little kids play with them.
They like them?
Yeah.
I've got no chinks.
Yes, you do. Shut up. Yes, you do.
No.
You play with them.
No, I don't.
Yes, sir.
I was walking down the street. Those kids sat on the porch of an apartment, say some bad words to me. It's like a VC, something like that, and a bunch of bad words. So I just turned out and asked him, what did you say and why did you say so? And he said that, you know, a lot of things. And he said, get out of here before you die. He had very definite behavior about Asian. And and then he swung his body and kicked me right here, spat at me from the top down here.
Many racial attacks are not reported by Asians, out of fear mainly. But Nguyen did call the police. He got help and even a job as an interpreter. Imagine, if you can, a Jew, an Irish Catholic, a WASP, and a Vietnamese working together as a group to defend victims of racial prejudice. Only in America, you might say, and the place is Boston, Massachusetts. The group is the Community Disorders Unit of the Boston Police Department.
I'd like to belatedly welcome you here to America. And the first thing I want to tell you is, the first day you stepped into America, you were given the same rights as everybody in this room. You have the same rights as I do.
In a class for newly arrived Asian refugees, Chuck Wexler, the unit director, Detective Brian Flynn, and Nguyen Pham spell out some of the dark corners of that vision of freedom. Only in America would such a diverse unit exist, but only in America, it seems, do we have this recurring problem in so many varieties.
If you walk with your head up and you make eye contact, you look in people's eyes, you don't have to stare at them, but just look. You will put a message out that you're not an easy target.
Much of the field work for Flynn and Detective Bill Dickinson involves interviewing victims of racial incidents, trying to get them to identify their assailants.
Would you be willing to have one of our officers up here,
yeah,
or drive around with us in a surveillance vehicle that you could see out of but they could not see into, and point that boy out to us?
Yes, I will.
Yes.
If we can find this boy, you can identify him.
Yeah.
Are you going to be willing to go to court, yeah, and testify?
Outside, on the street, are the white, usually Irish Catholic teenagers who often foment the racial trouble. They are without jobs, so drinking, dope, and harassing refugees becomes their day.
What we're dealing with are kids who don't even know why they hate somebody. I mean, if you could stop and ask these kids, well, why do you hate blacks? Or why do you hate Vietnamese, Puerto Ricans? They probably couldn't give you an answer. But it's probably a case where they've heard statements over a breakfast table, over a dinner table, from a parent or an older brother. And they're just repeating that. They've been conditioned to that. We can tell them. If you step out of line and you harass someone or assault someone and violate their civil rights, we're going to do something about it. But we can't tell them to love thy fellow man.
Every city has its worst street, a place that usually means trouble, even violence. In Dorchester, honors for worst go to Melbourne Street. It is on this quiet, leafy stretch of quaint houses that a black family was burned out of its home last year. This year, Southeast Asian families are the new target.
How do you feel about them living here?
Well, they're sloppy. They're not from around here, that's why they're sloppy.
Have you ever talked to them?
His name's Haimo. Don't forget your name.
Yeah, Haimo.
We call him Haimo. Really, serious, Haimo.
We call one of them Bozo.
Fish Face. Who else?
Yeah, Fish Face, Bozo, and Haimo.
Shaggy. I think they should be able to live wherever they want to, but they know that this, especially like this street, has a reputation for trouble, not for just Asian people, but for blacks too. And they should have like sort of maybe knew before they moved in, but maybe they didn't have a choice. They didn't have any place else to live. That they should have known that there would be trouble if they lived here. They're black or Asian. It's the same prejudice that people have against them when they move into an all-white neighborhood. But it's like that almost everywhere.
This Dorchester's always been like that. It's a real racial neighborhood. Everyone's real, it's a lot of prejudice in here.
Yeah.
Professor Donald Polk.
There are parts of the city that I would love to enter and just see. I won't go. I will not go. There are times in this city that when I enter the subway, I enter with my back right against the wall. I'm not afraid of everybody in the community. I'm not afraid of everybody in South Boston. I'm not afraid of everybody in Charlestown. I'm not afraid of everybody in East Boston. It's just that I don't know which ones or two to be afraid of. See, it doesn't take the whole community to hit me across my head. It only takes one person. And I think you have black people who live in this community, and probably Asians too, who live in this community, who will never see the Constitution, the ship, the Constitution, who will never visit Bunker Hill Monument, you know, who will hesitate to go to other parts of the city.
And if someone was to ask what the main theme of Christ's message was over the past 2,000 years, it would have to be the theme of peace.
Many of the Southeast Asian refugees, both Catholic and non-Catholic, have gravitated to neighborhood churches such as St. Margaret's in Dorchester. Here they find those who have the time and inclination to help them, not unlike other immigrants who arrived at the turn of the century. Father Ronald Coyne grew up in Dorchester, but these days he's not always happy about what he sees.
Look at all these, the kids that live in this neighborhood are beautiful people, they're beautiful families, we know them real well, we're over their homes, at church here, and sometimes I see that and I say, what happened? Sometimes they say, where did I go wrong? And you look at a beautiful, you say, gee, it's a beautiful family, I know they didn't hear that in their family or at home. Where did they pick it up? Or why don't they see that this is just contrary to everything that Christ stood for and everything that the church stands for? I don't know.
Racism may shatter illusions and test patriotism, but for many, the vision of freedom remains intact. For some, like these two Laotian brothers, it is still unfolding. 17 years ago, an American bombing raid killed their father, and they thought their mother, too. Only 2 years ago, they learned she was alive and on her way to them in America. On this day, the day of her arrival, the cycle began again. Another vision of freedom would be tested.
Welcome to America. Thank you. Thank you.
Two Vietnamese brothers were accused when antagonisms in a Texas Gulf fishing village exploded into murder last summer. Yesterday, a judge directed the acquittal of one defendant. The day the jury brought in its verdict regarding the other. Bob McNamara reports.
21-year-old Win Van Sao was found innocent of murdering a Seadrift crab fisherman during an argument last August over fishing rights. The jury apparently believed the young refugee's testimony that he had acted in self-defense. Billy Joe Applin was the shooting victim, and during the trial, he'd been portrayed as a bully who'd often accused Vietnamese immigrants of stealing his crab fishing traps. Still, the jury's verdict is not expected to end the bitterness and hostility that's grown between the South Vietnamese immigrants and the people of Seadrift, the Gulf Coast town where the shooting took place.
There's been some idle threats made. Some of them were fairly reliable that there could be some real violence here in town.
And Seadrift's Vietnamese immigrants, especially the crab fishermen, are the most afraid of trouble. They fear they, their families, or their livelihood may be attacked by people who openly talk of avenging Billy Joe Applin's death.
Well, somebody's gonna probably take care of those Vietnamese.
Take care of them.
Kill them.
Town officials say they'll hire extra police and impose a curfew to keep the lid on Seadrift, but even if it's calm, local suspicions and hatreds may not die.
Put them somewhere and make Americans out of them before they bring them down here on us.
It don't matter to me, but I'd like to see them to get civilized and get to act like us.
Native crabbers here still accuse the Vietnamese of trying to drive them out of business by selling crabs cheaply, by allegedly stealing the natives' catches, and by accepting low wages. It's an economic war, but the Vietnamese, struggling to build new lives, appear determined to live and work in Seadrift despite these hostile times. Bob McNamara, CBS News, Seadrift, Texas.
Back from a five-day swing through Ronald Reagan territory on the West Coast, Republican presidential candidate John Connally now is heading into Teddy Kennedy country in New England. And Connally, the former Texas governor...
...is the first item of business in a hearing today by the U.S. Commission on Civil Rights. The agenda includes a report on increasing attacks against the 5 million Asian Americans in this country. Harold Dow found increasing protests over the often unspoken violence against their community.
Massachusetts, Christmas morning. 21 Cambodian refugees burned out of their home. The cause? Arson. Davis, California. A Vietnamese high school student is stabbed. Philadelphia. Another group of Asians, the Hmong, are driven from their homes by fear and intimidation. And in New York City, a Chinese-American family accused police of racial assault. It's called Asian bashing, and all across the United States, Asians have seen the handwriting on the wall.
I just don't like them. I don't get along with them.
Savages.
Wow, wow, wow.
I don't like them. You know, this is our country, not theirs.
Anytime they take a job that's offered to them, it takes a person that's lived here in the United States out of a job.
That kind of attitude apparently led to the killing of Vincent Chin in Detroit. In that case, the people who attacked Chin and eventually beat him to death apparently believed that he was Japanese or Japanese American or something and had something to do with the fact that they were out of work.
Tom Watson is a former staff member for the U.S. Commission on Civil Rights. He led the research team that did a study on violence against people of Asian descent. The commission could not determine how often violence or acts of intimidation occur because many crimes in Asian communities go unreported. But the commission concluded that Asians are being attacked because of racism, competition for jobs, and a perception that all Asians are foreigners.
And I think the best way to deal with this problem is to educate people and to organize Asians in such a way that we can viably say we're not going to take this anymore.
One family that says it's not taking it anymore is the Wongs, Chinese Americans living here in New York. Last month, four members of the family got into a scuffle with police. The Wongs say it was racially motivated police brutality. The cops say the Wongs resisted arrest.
They told me to go over here, right? I said, what happened? I told them many times, my wife got a baby, can't touch. Nobody can touch. He said he don't care.
And I thought I lost my baby because I have every pain on my stomach because she pushed me on my chest first and she swung. And the second time she swung with a handcuff on my left eye.
The Wongs intend to sue the police, but the real battle for Asian Americans will not be waged in a courtroom. These people know the battle can only be won when the other America looks at their faces and doesn't ask who they are or where they come from. Harold Dow, CBS News, New York.
Right, how this happened.
Yes. I want him to say it to me in English, and he says English is very good.
Right, I think he feels more comfortable for me to translate what he says.
If he could try to talk to me in English, it would be much better. People who are listening at home, they will feel for him more, okay? So tell me what you saw and what happened at your store.
The riot started Wednesday, but Wednesday my store was okay. I respect my neighbors, and I treat my neighbors kindly very well. All my neighbors like me, and then they are not gonna break my store. But next day, Thursday, I open the store, and 12 o'clock noon time, some black guys hang around, and I got threatened, and so I close the door and leave. 1 minute later, I come back to my store. I was going to open my store to my neighbors. And then they hit the head with hammer store already. I tried to open the door, but I cannot do that. And so I said, well, go ahead, what you want? And then I leave there, leave home. And I watch the TV, and two hours later, bust bomb. But fire statement is come down here got down.
And the fire station finally came and they extinguished the fire. I think the man is, what he's trying to basically express in a few words is that he did not mind so much the fact that they came in and looted his store. What angers him and why he's so emotional is the fact that they burned the store. And that is his entire livelihood. He has a family, he has children, he has people to support. He's in very strong emotional, he's very angry, very sad right now.
How long have you been here in America?
1.5 years.
1.5 years?
And then all my neighbors likes me. Right. But some black guys, they don't know who is enemy. Enemy is not Korean. Korean is their friend. Dear friend, we gotta open the store in the black people area. They are convenient too. They are from us, but they don't know. Yeah. But they don't have money. They need food.
And so, what will you do now? What will you do?
Korean Americans.
I always treat I have no idea now. I need money.
But
what I said now, black people's enemy, not Korea, not Asia. 200 years ago, white people take the black people from the Africa and they use the same.
And
sometimes they forget, sometimes they remind. Asian and Korean, not their enemy. We are all friends.
Okay. Tell me your name and spell it for me, please. You can help me out here.
But my name is Charles.
Charles. Is that really your name, Charles?
Yeah, Charles.
We
Last name, Yotin.
Last name, Chong.
C-H-U-N-G. Okay, and you've been here for a year and a half, and you built your store.
No, I've been here. America is 11 years.
Okay.
But I run a store is 1.5.
We pray that you will be. Okay, thank you. You wanted to tell me.
Yeah, I wanted to tell you. Just to
tell me why you're here today.
Right, I'm here today basically to say, you know, that we're really outraged. We're angry at the lack of police protection that we received as a community. You know, they say that there's protection for all citizens equally, and that's just a crock. You know, I feel that, I mean, for someone very close to me, he owned a furniture store in South Central LA, and he went in there when he saw on TV that his store was being looted. So he went there with his employees to stop the looting. The police were one block away, and they were standing there, five of them together, watching. And when he went in there to stop the looters, two of the men grabbed iron rods, and they struck him violently to the head. Now, there was no news coverage of this event. Now, he is one of many Korean merchants who have been brutalized in this way.
Yes.
And not only that, he is in the USC Medical Center for a head contusion. He's gone through surgery, very violently attacked. And I am very frustrated at the level of news media coverage for these type of violent events. I've been watching news. I've been sitting there all day hoping to see this kind of violence portrayed in the media, and I haven't seen it. That's why I came out today. I've been actually hunting down these cameras to say what I want to say. And I want to say that black community, we love you. You're not our enemies, you know, and we empathize with your struggle. We know that as we need you very much. We need you. And I believe that you need our service too. And I just really pray and hope and pray sincerely to God that we can be united and fight this racist structure, racist system that we live in right now. And that's why we're all here, basically.
Okay, let me back up and ask you something. You said the police were a block away. They
right.
didn't do anything.
Right.
Why do you think that happened?
You know, I really don't know. I don't know. And that's why I think there's a high level of frustration among the Korean community. They have not publicly come out and give us an adequate explanation. We demand an explanation from Chief Gates. A lot of these community merchants have been completely distraught by this because there's not a level of explanation for this.
Well, there's a lot of Korean business people who said we feel like we've been singled out.
Right.
Do you feel like that?
By the blacks, or by the blacks,
people who are rioting, you feel like you were kicked on and left alone.
Right, right.
Yourself.
You know, let me tell you another thing that really disturbed me. Yesterday on Channel 4, NBC News, over and over again, they recounted the case of Yoo. They showed the video over and over again. I thought that was completely unnecessary.
Channel 9 also, would you say something
okay.
about that?
Okay, well, actually,
and this is for national news, and people
right.
in Omaha aren't going to know anything that happened on Channel 4 here.
Right, but
tell
I think,
me.
I think
if you can answer this question for me.
Right.
Do you feel like you were singled out?
I do feel we were singled out, but not so much by the African American community, but we were singled out by the police LAPD department.
And I have one opinion. 얘기해 주세요. 내가 그 근처에서 1년 반 같이 있어보니까 흑인들은 너무 가난하고 흑인들을 교육을 시키지 않으면은 예, 안 되고 예, 무기에다 돈 쓰지 말고 예, 흑인들을 교육시키는 데 돈을 써가지고 그래야 미국의 평화가 온다고
얘기했어요. He just wants to say that he worked in the black community for 1.5 years and he really empathized. He thinks the black community, they are cool but nice, good-hearted people. And he feels right now that a lot of more national funds should be directed to the education program in the ghettos, in the black communities. That a lot of our funds should be targeted towards improving the educational system right now. So that's the way he feels.
Yeah. Okay, what are you going to do next? What's the answer? What do you do to rebuild your community?
I think we're all here as a show of support. We're going to put our hands together, put our heads, and put our resources together. Hopefully, you know, with manpower, bring a shovel and brooms out, clean up the place, and hopefully we're just going to try to pick up the pieces, and it's going to be very, very difficult.
What we have to do is build up the awareness to what the true problem is, okay? And then go
what
on
do you think the
it.
True problem is?
The true problem is lack of education, lack of justice, and the feeling of violent people. I got a call yesterday about 11 to 12 o'clock by my parents. They told me that our warehouse was being broken into. It took me 15 minutes to get there. By that time, my mother had been shot, and my father had taken my mother to the command center to get an ambulance. When we got there, the store was not being looted. When we left for 15, 20 minutes to try to look for my mother, the looting had begun, okay? I don't mind the store being looted. 15 minutes later, 20 minutes later, they set the place on fire. I don't think they entered the warehouse.
What kind of warehouse was it? What?
Oh, electronic warehouse for TV, stereos, everything.
Where was it?
It was on Venice and Western. Very 1 block away from Venice and Western.
And how is it that your mother ended up being shot? Do you know?
As they were fleeing, basically. The alarm went off, and my father went out to check out the situation. As they were fleeing, she was shot in the leg. Like the gentleman said in the back, the black people are not our enemies. Okay, and Korean Americans and Asians are not the enemies of the black people.
Do you feel like you were left alone to fend for yourself, that no one here protects you?
For three days, we were told the National Guard was here. For 3 days, we were told police were there. Where were they? We didn't see a single policeman or a National Guardsman until it was all over. We didn't see anyone until last night, basically. Until everything was burnt down, there was nothing more to steal or to burn. Okay?
What are you and your parents going to do now about your business? Do you know?
Please stay here. We would like to rebuild. But what we need is community support. Okay? Like the other gentleman said, what we need is education for the minorities, the black people. We need more money spent on education. We have no more war left. What we need is more money spent on education and not on welfare.
Okay, can you tell me your name and stuff?
Yes, my name is Richard Kim.
K-I-M?
K-I-M.
Thank you, Richard.
Any sort to happen. Can I say something?
Yes.
This is really sad. Still, I just came over here about 15 minutes ago. I learned through the Western Avenue and the Bevan Avenue. People still break the window, traveling out whatever they want, either their kid, looks like their mom and grandmom. That's why I don't understand what is going on between National Guard and the police paper. See, when I see the TV yesterday, between the Channel 5 and Channel 9, they focused the Korean market who protect their property with gun. The thing is, they just showed that when they're shooting to the people. But they didn't bring out to people why they shooting to the people. Because they tried called the police and National Guard, even the 911, thousand times nobody show up. Even though they just show up, they just mapping and pass it out. So in case for you, if I are going to your house with a pistol or whatever something, then you call the police, then they show up, pass to your house. What are you going to do? You're going to just say, hey, welcome? No, right? But thing is, other than that way, whenever these people see the news, they just see Korean guy kick their pistol against the sea on paper. So it's to me, your press people do that, and some other nation people think, where Korean people just killed the people.
Tell me your name and spell for me,
please. I got one of our business out in the black community area, too.
Okay, tell me your name and spell it for me.
Mr. E, Y-I.
Okay,
yeah.
Thank you. Hi. Yes, one last thing.
One comment I wanted to make was, there was tremendous news coverage for the rioters, the tremendous news coverage for the people doing the looting, but there was tremendous lack of coverage, or sometimes no coverage, of the victims. We are the victims here, as well as the black community, a victim of injustice. We are the victim of violence. Okay? I think to get a fair story, you gotta go buy some of these burnt out buildings. Talk to more people that had their homes, their lives destroyed. Okay? Those are the true victims of violence. Those are the true victims. And those are the people that need coverage.
Okay, thank you very much. What is it that you want to say?
Yes, in reference, I guess, a rebuttal to Nightline yesterday from ABC with Ted Koppel.
Okay, we're from CBS, so we don't usually apologize for Ted.
We're not asking for an apology in a sense, but a rebuttal, because last night, I was watching Nightline, and with great curiosity and concern because of all the things that were happening here. And they had a forum yesterday, and it was, of course, comprised of all of the black people there, and the impression they are giving out to the whole of the country as well as to the world is that it is the Koreans with the Sunjadu case, with the Latasha killing, that has begun this madness. And it isn't so. For every Latasha that were killed, there were hundreds of Korean merchants that were murdered, which were never reported in the news.
Right.
Yes. We're not asking, okay, for us to be in the media. However, I think the media has to be fair. Why is it that they are reporting one murder of the black girl, which we do not condone? Okay, we condemn such behaviors. It was wrong for a lady to kill a girl for $1.79. That is terribly wrong. We condemn it by all means. However, every time, for the 19 years that I live here in the States, every time I watch the news, whichever television station it may be, it is never portrayed as we Koreans have been, you know, we have been victimized for all these years. And it is we who are instigating and who are beginning this madness, which isn't so. I mean, look around. I mean, it is we who are victimized for millions of dollars here. Where's the National Guard? I mean, where's the police protecting? And then yesterday, of course, the last 3 days, I was sickened to my heart to see that they were pulling down the Koreans because they have guns, because, you know, they were protecting their own properties. And yet, there were no police there, no National Guards, none. They were coming to protect our properties, and yet, what they were doing was, as they were showing the Koreans merchants with their weapons, as they were pulling them and throwing them onto the streets, it is as if we had begun this misery, this madness, and it is so unfair. It is so terribly wrong. And I think all we ask is for some fairness in the news coverage, because, you know, yesterday they had that forum at 9:09 at the first AMC, and then throughout everywhere, you know, all they are ever saying is that the Koreans are arrogant people. Yes, we're not the most perfect people. Koreans are owning all the liquor stores and I guess distributing a lot of the evils, and that may be true, but, you know, we are trying to make a living here, and they work 12, 16 hours a day, hard living. We don't cheat people in that sense.
Okay.
You know,
I'm going to have to stop because we have to go, but please tell me your name and spell it.
Joshua Lee.
L-E-E? J-O,
yeah.
Okay, thank you.
The explosion that rocked Los Angeles was at least partly fused by years of ethnic friction, and it's not just black and white population in all of Los Angeles. Blacks make up less than 15% of the population here, Latinos almost 40%, and Asians just under 10%. In South Central, blacks are in the majority with almost as many Latinos and very few Asians. Antonio Hernandez is president of the Mexican-American Legal Defense and Educational Fund. Jerry Yu is executive director of the Korean-American Coalition. And Shannon Reeves serves as regional director of the NAACP. And they join us this morning. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
The events of the last 6 or 7 weeks have forced you together in some ways. In a significant way, in a meaningful way, in a positive way, do you think?
Well, I think in all, but your question assumes that we were not communicating before, and we were communicating before. We were working with the different ethnic groups. It's just that we need to take that down to the grassroots level. It's not enough to have it at the leadership level, and I think that's what was happening.
Is that what was missing? Is that people in suits were talking to each other a lot, but maybe people on the streets were not communicating effectively?
Yeah, I think that's true. For the past couple of years, for example, the NAACP and MALDEF, and we have been working together on redistricting for statewide offices as well as local offices. So people have been working together. It's just that, it hasn't really reached down to the majority of people in our communities.
Mm-hmm. Help people across the country understand the enmity that exists among different racial groups here. What is the greatest source of bad feelings, say, for instance, between African Americans and Asians?
Well, there have been tremendous problems through the years. But even though we've talked about the problems between those who buy goods and those who sell them, I think the more important thing that has come out of all of this is that we have learned at this point, at the most fundamental levels, that that we are not each other's enemy. My Korean brother, that is not my enemy. My Latino sister, that is not my enemy. Our common enemy is ignorance, that we are not, we don't have the full understanding of our own communities and cultures. Mm-hmm. And once we develop that, then and only then we'll be able to move on. That's the good that has come out of all of this.
Jerry, is there good out there? Do you hear from people who have stores that there is a difference now, or is it the same old thing?
You know, we cannot deny that there are different cultural differences as well as misunderstandings. But to blame what happened here in LA, the uprising, on the relations between, say, two communities, blacks and Koreans, is it's ridiculous, because it's like blaming the trade deficit between Japan and the United States as a cultural difference. Sure, there are differences, but we know that it's very complicated, and there are a lot of different angles to the situation.
Antonio, tell me about the basic root of enmity between Latinos and, say, African Americans here.
You know, once again, there are some, but not as many. Let me put it in the context. You stated that South Central is predominantly African American. In fact, in some areas, the majority is Latino, recent immigrants. And if you talk about a community going in transition from an African American to a Latino in 10 years, and there's been minimal, the problem is unemployment. The problem is poverty, and that is among Latinos, African Americans, and Asian Americans. And the frustration that you saw was the inability for all of the poor people to have access to a job so they can earn a decent living. To say that it's majority racial and ethnic, mm-hmm. and not economic, is missing the boat. And I think that that's the thing that we're talking about right here. There are some differences, but not as significant.
Go ahead, Jerry.
I think what you're getting at is, I think there is a bad atmosphere in this city, and it's happening nationwide as well. There are race politics going on, racial politics, where different people from different communities are being defensive, and they're being justifying different actions. I hear a lot of local leaders saying, you know, I'm black, or I'm Latino, or I'm Korean, and this kind of... it's creating an atmosphere where all of us, it's getting hard for all of us to see clearly, to look at what are the real problems that we are facing, all of our communities are facing. Mm-hmm. And there are these broad societal problems that have existed, for example, even before Koreans immigrated to this country, things such as the lack of real opportunities for jobs, the lack of real educational opportunities, you know, police brutality. These things are things that Korean Americans did not create. But we know that, having been in this country, that we have to be part of the solution.
We look
now.
Back. We look back less than a century, and there was a lot of ethnic enmity among recent European immigrants in the United States, and there were jobs in steel mills and automobile plants and all of those kinds of things that helped lift people away from the ghettos they came and lived in originally. Are there going to be jobs? Do you believe that the dreams that all of you share can be fulfilled in the community you live in?
Well, jobs are very important, but I believe, number one, in the African-American community, we must understand that the African-American community controls some $350 billion a year. Our responsibility, number one, is to buy from our own merchants and to spend dollars in our own communities and to put our money in our own banks to mm-hmm. finance our own dreams initially. So the job question is a serious one, but that is not what caused so much the rebellion. We were talking about an injustice that was done. And I heard a professor say once, blind racism begets blind rage, and that's what you saw there. But to move a step further than that, we've seen what has happened in the past. The key now must be to plant seeds in our young people. We must touch the minds of youth that watch this whole thing on television, mm-hmm. because 20 years from now, they will be our leaders here in this community.
Mr. Reeves, Mr. Yu, Ms. Hernandez, thank you all very much for joining us. We'll be back.